the movement really started in the 50s.
I was not afraid to speak truth to power.
I came to see by spring of 69 that repressing people in high school was part of getting them lockstep into the military.
By the time I was, you know, a teenager, I was aware that there was something happening, something great that was happening, and I'm going to get on that train and be a part of it.
They were going to build a freeway, and I had a vague idea of how big a freeway was, but I knew what it would do to the community.
And then I got involved in one night we went out and spray painted parking meters at the parking garage across the street, and there were anti-war slogans on the walls, like revolt for peace, you know. And so I was arrested for doing that. Didn't get away quite fast enough. And I remember the Washington Post, there was an article at some point about that, and there was a picture, and I think they had a picture that had the words revolt for peace. Mm-hmm. And that was perhaps my proudest moment.
Yes, I went to that march. I was a marshal at the march because I was very much involved with SNCC at that time. And I was a distance away from the staging area. And that really kind of like, oh my, I'm way over here, but I'm going to do my job. I had my little white cap on, and I'm going to stand in this corner, and I'm going to usher people into, you know, the larger area where everything is going on. I could hear because the loudspeakers were there, but I couldn't see anything. And lo and behold, Malcolm X walks into my little, you know, and so I did my job, you know, I'm escorting him, you know, over to where he's supposed to go next and that sort of thing, you know. But of course now, he's surrounded by the fruit of Islam, so he doesn't really, and also the press. But nevertheless, this was my little quadrant, and I'm doing, and it was just fascinating because he had said that he wasn't coming to this march. I mean, he didn't believe in it, but there he was. And, you know, he said, I think, if I got it correctly, that he could not come.
The Federation of Civic Associations, which in those days was all black, mm-hmm. Had already determined to organize. So here was Sam Abbott, who was white and Lebanese. We had Burchide sitting down with the Black Panthers. Mm-hmm. And they had the common single focus, which is the only way you can organize.
Mm-hmm. When you turn 18, there's another experience that's mandated by law, which I was aware of course, if you're a male, and that was to register the draft board. And you know, getting ready to come into this room for the interview, I remembered, oh, don't I carry this thing around in my, I never got around to burning it. This is my draft card.
Oh my God.
There was a wide spectrum of people there. There were ladies from DuPont Circle in dresses. There were suburbanites. There were troublemakers. I call them people who acted like they were in dashikis, but their shoes were shined, so you knew they weren't.
If you didn't want to go into the military, you were supposed to, if you wanted a conscientious objector status, you would apply, make an application on the appropriate form. Well, I went down to the draft board in Silver Spring, and I pulled a leaf off a tree outside the draft board, and I said, this is my application.
Someone, and no one will ever own up to it. We don't know who did it. We don't know why. We didn't need to do it. We were ready for anything that was going to come through an ashtray. And that's all it took. The city council then called the SWAT team in, which were manned and ready to go. And they just rammed through the whole hearing room. And the trick was, if you were afraid, that meant you were attacking them. Mm-hmm. So putting your hands up when you're being attacked or someone's coming at you was a sign that you were really going to hit them. Mm-hmm. And so everybody got arrested.
You know, we had a number of big leaders, big names, but it really was from the ground up. It really was a groundswell of little people who made a big difference.